Hello everyone, welcome this evening. This evening we have the privilege of welcoming Mr. Martin Brocklehurst. Just a brief introduction. He has actually worked in the oil industry. He also has worked in different environmental organizations. And he also is the founder of the European...
Citizen Science.
One of the founders. He has been here before, talked about circular economy, which I came to last year, which is very interesting and fascinating. He works now also doing some project as an independent consultant for the European Union. I think it's a wonderful privilege to welcome him today, and also, least but not least, he's the father of Mr. Sean Brocklehurst. So, without further ado, and also I'd like to thank Mr. Harlan for organizing this all and tying this whole together with the science classes. So, please.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Could I ask you first and foremost, if you've got your mobile phones with you, leave them switched on. But in silent mode, so they don't ring. You can have a chance to use them as we go through the presentation. So, as you've heard, I act as an independent consultant, but tonight I'm going to talk to you in my role working with the European Citizen Science Association, whose remit in life is to connect citizens and science through fostering active participation. And the vision is that in 2020, citizens in Europe are valued and empowered as key actors in advancing knowledge and innovation, and thus supporting the sustainable development of our world. There is a view that citizens are not connected with some of the activities, the environmental directives of the Commission, and we want to try and change that. A brief history of the organisation, I won't bore you with too much detail, but it's very new. From our first meeting in London in 2012, through to its formation as a non-government organisation in 2014. And it's come together largely as a result of the initiatives from Imperial College London, the Natural History Museum in Berlin and London, and the Natural History Museum in Marisma, which is in Tuscany in Italy. And it's rapidly grown from its foundation. Just to say as well that in the process we gained the support of the European Environment Agency, and Professor Jacqueline McGlade, who was the director at the time, was an enthusiastic supporter of the need for a citizen science group in Europe. She is now the chief scientist to the United Nations Environmental Programme, and you'll see later on that she's taken her thinking on citizen science with her to the UN. And likewise, the launch of the programme was by Environment Commissioner Janis Potocnik, who was the top man at the European Union for environmental policy at the time. So we had some fairly senior level support. Since then, we've also gained support from the Leiden Natural History Museum in the Netherlands, and the Paris Natural History Museum, the French Natural History Museum in Paris, and the Natural History Museum in Barcelona, and a cohort of organisations coming together. Citizen science is all things to all men, but this is just trying to show you what it actually encompasses. And at the top is what traditionally has been citizen science for over 100 years, which is the active specialist, the amateur professional, who probably knows more about the topic area they're studying than many of the scientists who are working with them. And that's then right down to the bottom here, which is the passive observer. This is where the citizen helps to monitor on behalf of scientists with no knowledge of the activity that's taking place. And that's crowdsourcing of data. And there's everything in between. And the opportunity to get involved in citizen science is tremendous at the moment. And it's largely brought about by the iPhone, by the internet, by the social media, all the things that you use every day in your life. Because they bring people together with technical innovation and science in a way that wasn't possible 30 years ago. And it's exploding across the world in terms of activity, not just in Europe, in America, in Australasia, in the Far East, in China. People are getting involved in this whole program. And just to say, this is it is traditional science we're talking about. So it's about setting a question, it's about answering that question through the gathering of data and interpretation, communicating the results, evaluating those results, and feeding those back into the scientific process. There is only one science, and citizen science follows the same methodology as a science undertaken by professional scientists in universities, and it's often led by professional scientists working in partnership with communities. And it has to break into perceptions that people have got that it isn't real science. Believe me, it is. Now let me see if I can get this to work, and it will introduce you, hopefully.
Scientists, public agencies and the private sector already collect many kinds of environmental data that can be used for the benefit of humanity. The Global Earth Observation System of Systems, or GEOS, gathers information from around the globe using space-based, airborne, marine, and terrestrial monitoring systems. Recent technological innovations funded by the European Commission now make it possible for citizens to participate actively in collecting data and monitoring their environment.
Can you hear that at the back, by the way?
To explain the idea of citizens' observatories, we can look at any modern European city. Air pollution is a real problem, and most cities can only afford a small number of fixed measuring points. These give accurate but limited data coverage. Now imagine we could have numerous smaller measuring stations with individuals gathering data in real time. These mobile monitors, which in the near future will become smaller and easier to carry, can give us a more complete picture of air quality. This is made possible by the miniaturization of sensors combined with the transmission capacities of modern smartphones. Citizens will not only be helping to collect data, they will also get something useful in return. Real-time pollution maps, for example, could indicate alternative travel routes, helping cyclists to avoid heavily polluted zones.
So the aim of citizens is to empower people in environmental decision-making, to give them new tools to assess their environment, bring them together in a citizens' observatory where they can discuss with other people about air pollution issues and try to influence decision-making.
Odors can be a real nuisance. They're hard to measure objectively and so cannot be regulated like other pollutants.
Information from the citizens are important because odor is a perception, it's not just a physical quantity. So we have to try to quantify the perception of the odors by the citizens.
First, a number of e-noses are being set up around the factory. The e-noses are linked to an odor dispersion model. Neighboring citizens make an important contribution by inputting their own perceptions of odors via tablet, smartphone, or internet. Information provided by the citizens will be checked and verified with the other data. Both the public authorities and the industry source will have a better base for informed local action. European businesses can use these innovations to generate services to citizens, industry, and governments, creating both wealth and job opportunities. Citizens can benefit not only from the mitigation of the odor nuisance, but also from having an active role in environmental governance. People have always been interested in observing their surroundings, whereas observation satellites and in-situ measuring stations are set up to monitor vast areas of ocean and coastlines. This could now be complemented with numerous smaller observations carried out by citizens. The widespread use of smartphones and the internet makes this possible. Simple apps will enable individuals to assess the transparency, color, and fluorescence of seawater.
These three parameters tell you a lot about the oceans, particularly when you have the three together in one place and in many, many places, which is where citizens come in.
Citizen science, I mean, the idea of the public getting involved in environmental monitoring is really important because it's not possible for government agencies to cover the kind of area and get the level of monitoring that you need.
The citizen's source data will automatically be uploaded to the internet, archived, processed, and finally made available through a mobile application or web page.
The citizen suddenly has this "I can do it" attitude and wants to contribute and wants to be taken serious.
The European Union is funding several pilot citizens' observatory initiatives. It's crucial that the data collected by citizens are made freely and openly available and accessible through the GEOS. Individuals will be recruited to play the role of observers through existing community groups and NGOs, schools and local authorities, plus word of mouth. Knowing that they will have greater influence over the development of their locality will give people a real incentive to become active citizen observers.
This is the next generation of air quality monitors shown on that video. They're now half the size that they were when that was made 2 years ago. And the school has been loaned two of them to experiment with to see whether they can be used locally to generate data from this area of Switzerland. So this is state-of-the-art technology available to you to experiment with over the next few months. And there are limited numbers of these available in Europe. 5 years' time, halve the size again. 5 years' time, halve it again. It will soon be a button on your lapel that you'll be able to use to work out what the air quality is that you breathe in your daily activity in where you live in Europe. Imagine how powerful that becomes in driving change in air quality when there are 400,000 deaths a year, early deaths, as a direct result of air pollution problems in Europe. Imagine now you're in Calcutta, or in Manila, or in one of the major megacities of the world, where the air pollution problem is five times worse than it is in the European Union, and how powerful these things become as drivers of change. So we're on the cusp of a revolution. It isn't just happening at European level, it's happening at international level as well, and this links you through to what I was talking about with Jacqueline McGlade setting up with the United Nations Environmental Programme something called UNEP Live. Don't worry about the detail, but if you're interested in citizen science, go have a look at the website, because on it you will find there is a citizen science component. This is designed at the moment for gathering data from member states, from the signatories to the UN conventions, but it's being built with the purpose of allowing citizens to allocate data into it as well. And this is the concept of the portal. It's like a tree drawing knowledge and information from a myriad of sources to basically work out whether we're tackling the world's global problems on sustainability effectively or not. And it gives the citizen a chance to be part of that wider discussion and debate, and to get the results presented back to them. There's no point in collecting data, sending to systems like this, if you can't analyse it and find out what it means to you in your locality. And this is part of the Citizen Science Portal. It has on it the beginnings of an inventory of citizen science programmes running around the world. SenseBox is quite an interesting one. It's a German initiative. And it's designed to be bottom-up. It's designed to use the Wikipedia principles of enabling you to interact with other technical people, other people who have an interest in your area, to build and design your own apps for telephones, your own systems, and in low-cost ways. So it isn't all top-down. Some of this is bottom, what we call bottom-up. NoiseTube is a system for measuring noise using your mobile phones and then running the data back into the database systems, and then understanding where you stand in terms of the relation of risks of environmental health from elevated levels of noise. Just some examples. It's supported by something else called iOnEarth, the iOnEarth network, which is in turn supported by a range of international bodies and organizations based in the Middle East, in Abu Dhabi, the Abu Dhabi Environment Agency, working in partnership to support the growth of citizen science globally. And the organisations that I referred to are down the bottom there, the World Resource Institute, the GEO, International Union of Conservation and Nature, and then two organisations based in Abu Dhabi. A summit literally a month ago in the Middle East, recognising the role the citizen science will play in making sure that the sustainability development goals of the UN are being met. This is revolutionary stuff. This is democracy at work. This is people getting involved. Back to Europe. This is the growth in 2 years of the European Citizen Science Association with virtually no budget and virtually no staff. It's all the goodwill of the people who are participating. It is growing like Topsy. It's hard to keep up at the moment. And although it's only 80 members from 22 countries, the members of those countries are the Natural History Museums of London, who have their own network of schools and communities who are working with them. And in the UK, something like 10% of 65 million people are linked through that network. In Germany, the estimate is of a similar percentage who can be linked through the network. At the moment, it feels a bit shambolic. There are so many initiatives going on. Trying to pull them together and coordinate them is hard. But the energy that is there is just stunning to experience. So, trying to get some strategy behind this matters if we're going to be taken seriously by the policymakers. And a lot of what we're trying to do here is to make sure that the data that is gathered is really used in setting the policies of tomorrow to tackle the environmental problems of today. So promoting sustainability through citizen science, one of the things that we're trying to look for are European-wide opportunities. There are many projects springing up that I'll take you through in a little while, but there are none at the moment that operate across the whole of the EU. So what we're looking for is the potential to grow projects into genuine European programmes with a reach of up to 10% of the European population. Imagine how powerful that becomes. And the other thing to bear in mind is when you start to do this, you have no control over where that programme goes. So it's not surprising on some of the programmes already, you find that what you start in Europe springs up in Singapore, or appears in Rio de Janeiro, or down in Sydney in Australia. Somebody picks up the idea from the social media, copies it, improves it, and uses it, and it grows globally. A lot of it is about sharing knowledge and skills, promoting expertise, and also trying to get the methods that people use understood and making sure that they are sound and effective. And we've got, as you might imagine, some working groups. I head up this one, Policy, Strategy, Governance and Partnership. That means talking to the policymakers in Brussels. It's pushing them to include citizen science in the legislation that they pass. At the moment, there isn't a single European directive that has citizen science built into it. Our aim for the future is to have every one of the directives include citizen science. So we have a long way to go. And you might argue your chances of success are quite small, but I would fundamentally disagree. So the road ahead is about networking and capacity building from the existing programmes across Europe, promoting EU-wide citizen programmes on things like tree health. One of the things that is happening in Europe is climate change is bringing a whole range of new invasive species into the European Union that are attacking the health of our tree species. And you only have to think of Dutch elm disease and how it wiped out the elm population to realise that there are a number of global diseases that could transform our forest environment. So that's one of the critical areas that we're looking at for EU-wide programmes. And supporting the EU environment and climate policies is another critical area, along with the whole business of data infrastructure. There's no point in collecting data unless it can be aggregated up into that UN programme that I showed you earlier. And just to show you that it is starting to integrate into policy, we've seen some remarkable developments in the US over the last 6 months, where the White House has recognized the value of citizen science in implementing environmental programs and health programs and other programs in the US. It isn't just environment. And I'll show you in a minute some of those examples. But the head of the executive agency in the White House has instructed all the agencies to appoint point of contact with citizen science and to collate all the existing programs in their respective areas to understand how to exploit it and use it more effectively. And the Republicans and the Democrats have even got together, amazingly, to put a bill in the Senate on citizen science. It will probably never see the light of day, as that's the way the legislative process works in the States. But the very fact they've drafted it indicates the seriousness with which they take citizen science now in the US. And they've built together a whole series of bits of information and kits for policymakers to use to work out how to use citizen science and crowdsourcing. And this crowdsourcing is incredibly powerful, not only for the policymakers, but for the people involved. So if you have a good idea in citizen science, and you use crowdsourcing, and you come bottom up, you can actually go onto the crowdsourcing network and generate the income to make it possible for you to do the project you want to do. And there are a number of examples now where people have done that. So you're not dependent on government funding. You can actually get your funding from the community that you're in. And that's very exciting. And again, don't worry about all the print on this page, but just look at that one line. 330 citizen science biodiversity projects contribute economic value of $2.5 billion per year. That's how powerful some of this stuff is becoming. And look at the list of projects. Sudden oak death is an invasive species in California affecting oak trees. Phenological research is looking at the economic impact of climate change. New astronomical objects working with NASA. I told some of the staff here today that the Hubble telescope in Europe makes all its data freely available. And a postman in a tiny town called Carlisle in the north of England discovered a new nebula that's now named after him. What on earth was a postman doing, looking at that type of technical data? You know, traditionally, the scientists would have said he would never find it. He wouldn't understand it. Wrong. He has a passionate interest in astronomy. And he now has a nebula named after him. What about that? Weather models, verifying their accuracy. The citizen can help the expert. Hazard data. Understanding that the earthquake patterns that exist in the US using citizen feedback. In Japan, when the tsunami hit, data came back from citizens to tell people about the extent of the damage that occurred. So using citizen science for natural hazards is a brilliant use of citizen science. Mapping the human brain and the ability of the human brain through a game, believe it or not, is another project that's been done in the US. And lastly, to mention, how good is the broadband? And those who know me and know where I live, I'm passionate about how bad the broadband is in the UK. In the US, they use citizen science to map it. Not the experts, the users who know what speeds they're getting. So the breadth of projects is enormous. Back to the EU. We're struggling a bit now in the EU. We've opened the door to citizen science, but we haven't embraced it yet. So one of the things the Commission have done is to produce a white paper that says, what are the opportunities for citizen science? How can we build a cohort of opinion that says citizen science should play a part in our policy-making process? Well, there are a number of leading nations now. I just listed a few here. Scotland, within the United Kingdom, is a leading nation on citizen science. It's building it into its environmental programs, its environmental regulation. Finland is targeting 20% of all its data on environmental reporting by 2020 from citizens, and coming up with some of the most amazing technology to make that possible. And go to Austria, go to Germany, they're formulating, as we speak, citizen science programs to work out how to take advantage of the opportunity that now presents itself. The Netherlands, Spain, and building on the citizen science observatories. You could not be at a better time to get involved in citizen science because it's an open field for ideas at the moment. And it's even appearing in Nature now. This is the editorial from Nature, literally 2 months ago, for the first time recognizing the legitimacy of citizen science and starting to question some of the way that the data is gathered. So this is the importance of making sure that the data is understood. And they highlight you go scuba diving in the summer. But while you're scuba diving, actually you see a lot. A simple technique for working out whether the water, the transparency of the water. Project here, a diver simply holds two boards like that, takes a photograph, and you can transmit that data back on your mobile phone when you come back to the surface, and they will calculate the transparency of the water for you. Now, if you're a diver, the transparency of the water is critical. It's actually commercially valuable data that you're gathering. But again, simple project, two cards and a camera. What a wonderful project. And if you want to read about it, well, John's got the slide, lots of material. It's just pouring off the presses at the moment. It really is a topical issue. And this one in particular is very good, by an American leader in citizen science, and the top one is a UK example. And also there is money associated with citizen science. You have to bid for it though, and it's quite a bidding process. The European programme largely started as a result of something called the Open Air Laboratory. And it's the first real example in Europe of citizen science for everyone. Traditionally, biodiversity monitoring has been for the active professional, the professional expert as I would call them. This programme is set to break that mould. It's set to recognise that 70 to 80% of us will live in cities by 2020, not in the countryside, totally disconnected from the biosphere. So what this programme set out to do was to link with people in the inner city areas, with the ethnic minorities, with the people who were unemployable, the out of work, people who had disability problems, and to show that anybody can do science, quite literally. And a whole range of programmes, biodiversity, tree health surveys, and a really nice one, which is an earthworm survey, mapping the invasion of a New Zealand species that is affecting the native population in the UK. People handling earthworms for the first time, wringing across their hand. You get all sorts of reactions when that happens. And the impact of that programme was to reach 10% of the population of England. Nearly 750,000 people, 2,000 schools, 1,000 organisations, 50,000 surveys, 21 scientific papers written. Real science, debunking some of the traditional views on science in the UK around soils analysis, for instance. Citizen science soil data in the urban areas contradicted the experts. So it had to be wrong, didn't it? No, it wasn't. Surveys were put in by specialists to validate the data. The citizen science data was correct. The specialist data was wrong. So citizen science data is a powerful driver of change because it can reach the parts of the urban area the specialists can't get to. You can't go into people's gardens and sample soils, but the citizen can. And there's a later programme going on in Barcelona, looking at tiger mosquitoes that are responsible for carrying dengue's fever into Europe, where the same is true, where the citizens are monitoring the location of breeding sites for the tiger mosquito, and programmes are then put in place to control the spread of that species and reduce the risk of dengue's fever. So something, an environmental project with a direct health benefit. And ordinary people benefit from that program. And one of the spots they found was the major park in the center of Barcelona where all the kids play. And the actual breeding site was a silt trap off the main pond, found by citizens. This is the Trees Across Europe Under Threat. The programme has been so successful in the UK that the government has now recognised for the first time that citizen science can be part of the mainstream response. They are now working with citizens to map and monitor the movement of diseases into the UK as climate change effects start to take effect within the UK. So it becomes part of the Tree Health and Biosecurity Action Plan. It's part of the Ash Dieback Management Plan, COLARA. It's part of a biosecurity expert task force, and it's all about plant biosecurity. And millions of pounds are tied up in this. You can wipe out coniferous woodland with some of these invasive species that are potentially coming in. You can wipe out the ash population, as has happened already in Denmark. But this is important stuff. And fantastic engagement. People love their trees. 50,000 survey packs, 750 trainers trained, tree buddies, surveys by schools, 38% of surveys by schools, 25% by adult volunteering groups and so on. And there's the spread already in 1 or 2 years. Still early days, but they're already starting to map diseases. Don't worry about the names, they're just examples of diseases spreading across the tree population of the UK. So this is mainstreaming the data that schools gather with policy change, which is what we're really all about at the European Citizen Science Association. What about elsewhere? Austria. This site says it started 3 months ago. It's actually 6 months ago now. They started their first project to host the projects that are running in Austria, pull them all together to try and get a coherent plan. The same thing is happening in Germany. So these are real programs that they're looking at to work out how they build them into the legislative process in Austria. So it isn't just the UK that is doing this in Europe. And now, an example of one of the Austrian projects and a chance for you to have a go at a citizen science project. This is called Roadkill. It started in Austria, it's now spread to Germany. It may be wider than that now because you can download the app. You can go onto your mobile phone and find the app and download it. And what it's trying to do is to map the incidence of kills on the road network for animals and reptiles and birds across Austria. And there is a real policy implication in this. Okay, so what they're trying to do is get an overview of the number and distribution of road kills, the underlying causes, to raise awareness for participants, and then to address the hotspots with either overpasses or underpasses on the highway network. Some of the animals that are affected here are red list species, protected by European legislation, and they're losing large numbers of some of these species in roadkill. And what they do is they build green overpasses on the motorway network when the data demonstrates that there's a real problem with roadkill. Because roadkill not only causes death to the affected animals and reptiles, but it also causes a lot of damage to vehicles. If you've ever hit a deer at 60 miles an hour, you know, not only do you kill the deer, but you wreck your car in the process. And you may actually cause a traffic accident. So that there are real economic advantages in understanding some of these issues. Now this is how it works. This is just to show you whether you're good or bad at this particular citizen science program. If you go onto your mobile phones, go to vote.boku@ac.at. That's this one here. Anybody got their mobile phones with them? Going to try it? Come on, let's see you all try it. We're going to give you feedback on the results, so if none of you do it, we'll get terrible results. Right? So vote.boku.ac.at. Have you found it? You got it? Has everybody got it?
No.
Making progress? Be able to type in a voting ID, RQRJ. Okay. So type in your voting ID. So the ID is RQRJ. And the question is, the photograph I'm going to show you, is it an amphibian? Is it a mammal? Is it a bird? Or is it a reptile? And the cue is, the first one is easy. You all got that? Yeah? Never slow, is it? Just put your voting ID in. I've got the ID on my phone.
What did you come here for?
That is a mammal. Who believes that it's not a mammal? Well, you're wrong, it's a mammal. Okay. So a nice simple one, it's a brown hare. A lot of fatalities in Austria for brown hares. Okay. The second one, which is meant to be challenging. So if you come across a roadkill victim, you should, let's see whether this one works. HBKQ. Now that one works. Put that one in. Try that one. HBKQ. That one's working. Okay. And then you're offered a choice. You all got that one working? Yeah? Okay. Now what's that?
If I use my nose, you like to go through
it. Can you all vote so we can move on?
Yeah.
I'm not telling the answer to that one, that has worked. Okay. You all voted. Okay. Let's try the third one. Press start. You should be able to put this one on the seat. This is working. So this is MJWF. Right. What's that? Mark clues there. now going to do is get the results for you, okay? So we'll see if we can get the results. Let's take the challenging one. Oh, well, that's not worked. That should give us the results. Hang on, let me just check I've done this right. Mammals. So the one that looks like a bird is in fact a bat, and the last one is a brown hare, exactly the same as the first one that you saw, and you can tell by the teeth on the roe. So apologies that you couldn't get to see the results. We might have another go at the end. You can see if we can get them back up on the screen. I may be doing something wrong. Let me go back to the presentation. Okay, just to show you, there is an application for this. If you can actually build this into the technology that people use now for route finding on in your vehicle, your sat nav, you can actually identify areas at risk of hitting road crossings from deer, from mammals, and from some of the bigger ungulates that occur in Europe. So again, you've got some data that is potentially commercially viable. That's the details for the roadkill project. You can download the app very easily. Okay, we've taken a bit longer over that. I want to just try and give you two other examples before I finish. The first is iSpecs, which is a way to monitor particulates in the atmosphere. And this is an app that goes on the mobile phone developed by a team in the Netherlands. There's the details. And that's how it works. The app sits on the phone with a transmission grater, a polarizer, and a whole set of technology. And John's got an example here that's been sent to the school to use. And this enables you to monitor particulates on your iPhone. Simply point it at the blue sky, and it will tell you how bad the air pollution is, the amount, the size of the particulates, and the composition. In other words, whether it's man-made, whether it's when you're near the sea, whether it's salt, or whether it's natural particulates. Amazing piece of technology, and very cheap now to produce. So potentially anybody can be a monitor for particulate emissions in the atmosphere. And that's why it matters. That's the health problems, the number of months people's lives are affected by poor air quality. And you can see there's a real bad area over here around the Netherlands, the port of Rotterdam, which is mainly due to shipping, believe it or not, rather than more traditional traffic. A lot of dirty fuel is burnt in ships' engines, and it's reflected in that map. It can also be used, you remember the volcanic ash problem with flights? Well, you can use this type of technology to measure the ash levels in the atmosphere as well. And it's one of the biggest unknowns in terms of impacts on climate change. So here we have a technology where the citizen can add real value to understanding the impact of aerosols on climate change. And it's had massive impact in the press. And it's spreading now across, this is the distribution, starting off in the Netherlands, yeah. It's now spreading across to other cities and starting to spread out from its original source within the Low Country. And it's one of the largest citizen science experiments that's currently running in Europe. The device is cheap, but we need large numbers of them. And it's based out from Leiden University. That's the distribution of sites in the Netherlands, literally in a year. And you can see how quickly people took to the system and how easy it is to monitor. You can also score the monitors as to the accuracy of the data, so that the longer you do this, the more accurate the data becomes, because you get familiar with the technology. And you don't point it at buildings or at clouds in the sky. And there's some of the monitors. Okay. Finland, I mentioned to you, is aiming to do 20% of its monitoring with citizen science. Simple technology here, take a water sample, put it in this black box, it analyzes the water, it put your mobile phone on the top, it talks to the mobile phone, transmits the data to a database. There is no way on earth that the Finnish government can monitor the water quality in all the lakes in Finland. If you've ever been to Finland, it's full of lakes. But with this technology, you can ramp up the scale of the monitoring activity. And my favourite one, this is using strawberry plants to measure benzene levels in Antwerp. So they gave out strawberry plants to people in Antwerp to work out the detail of the air pollution problem within the city. And they intended to give out 1,000 strawberry plants, they gave out double that. Once this hit the media, everybody wanted a plant. And it brings a smile to people's faces. You get strawberries out of it as well. It's actually adding something to understanding on air pollution. That's just the city of Antwerp, some of the people involved, the distribution, the density of the distribution of the monitoring that took place. The leaves are what give you the data. You send the leaves in for analysis, not the whole plant. And they got about 75% of the plants back. And they started to show the impact of the canyon effect in the streets and different height elevations with pollutant loads. Don't worry about the details, it's the principle that matters. And what they showed is it works. A lot of science went behind understanding the bioaccumulation of these materials in the leaves of the strawberry plant. and the strawberry plant is specifically chosen for the project. It's grown already from Antwerp, it's covering Flanders, it's moving into the Netherlands. More and more people want to take part. So that's air benzene. And what you find is when you analyse, this is 50 citizen science programmes, data gathering is a massive objective of many of them. But increasingly we're starting to see data gathering for policy implementation, policy review, lobbying, policy compliance, and new policy issues. And what we're really talking about in citizen science now is this is the traditional cohort, the postgraduate, the university, a little bit at the high school level. It's growing, the number of people that take part in citizen science, and it's moving it across into just from dust data collection to influencing the type of programs that are implemented so they're actually relevant for ordinary people. And moving down to the literacy levels, and just to show you some examples from outside Europe, where now you're going down to these populations in the Peruvian rainforest, where you're using mobile phones, telephone apps, to identify species distributions in the rainforests with people who can't read and write. And they're simply using pictures on the mobile phones. And the data is really good. Because actually the people who know more about the rainforest are the people who live there. So this isn't just the sophisticated Europeans, this is now going out to a much wider remit. And we're now looking at where we should concentrate our effort in Europe. And one of the EU Green Week in 2015, we asked something like 700 people, who are all experts in their field, where they would concentrate the effort. And one of the big ones was pollinators. We're actually wiping out the pollinators of our major crops. So understanding the distribution of bees, bumblebees and butterflies that pollinate our crops is a major economic issue. You can now go to parts of the states where they ship in bees to pollinate the crops because the native bee no longer exists. And what we're anxious about in Europe is to avoid that type of problem. And you can also see a huge interest in this problem of invasive alien species coming into Europe with climate change. And the other one that surprised me is wilderness monitoring. The few wildernesses we've got left in Europe to monitor that they stay that way. So those are some of the thinking that's going on. Let's skip that one. I want to finish with just a thought of another area of citizen science that's starting to emerge. Those of you who listened to me last year will know we talked about the circular economy. And we talked about the problem of plastics that are in everyday use. If you take polypropylene, which is the main plastic that you use every day, less than 5% of it is recovered and recycled. 95% of it disappears somewhere. It either disappears and is burnt to produce energy, or it goes to landfill, or it disappears into the environment. And marine litter, if you go around the world, is one of the big three or four major problems facing the globe. And if you've seen the big gyres in the Pacific, and the problems you get in the Middle East, the Far East, and the impact it's having on wildlife, it is stunning. But it's not just wildlife that's affected. The plastic breaks down into tiny granules and it gets ingested by fish, and we used to think it went straight through the gut. No longer. You're now finding plastic in the flesh of the fish, in the flesh of oysters, which is brand new science. So now we're beginning to have a problem like the Romans had with lead in pipes, for those who are familiar with their history. That we're beginning to find plastic as ubiquitous in our natural environment, which is not good for us as a species. And 80% of that plastic comes from land, not from dumping off ships. And it already is costing 10 to 13 billion euros to clean up litter in Europe. There is no EU-wide agreed method of monitoring litter, so we've no idea where the worst problems are, and it's this litter that is getting into the sea. And how do we know? Because we've just started to monitor levels in the rivers. The very first data came from the Danube 4.2 tons of plastic every day into the Black Sea. And the Black Sea is a closed sea. It doesn't leave the Black Sea once it enters. It just builds up in the ecosystem. And virtually no data on the other rivers. And you can see some of the photographs of plastics moving down the river. Some of it's on the surface, some of it floats underwater, some of it runs on the bed of the river. So one of the things you can do, even in Switzerland, is get involved in actually measuring land-based litter. Which is, say, 80% of it comes from land. And in Switzerland, you have a new group that's been set up to try and focus attention on the litter problem in Switzerland. And you have, for the very first time, a common methodology beginning to emerge across Europe in how to measure this stuff. And if you can measure where it is, you can do something about it. And it's a contribution in this area to reducing marine plastics in the Mediterranean. Because that's where the drainage goes from here, down the Rhone, into the Mediterranean. So that's just another example. And I hope tonight has given you some understanding of what's going on globally, and what the opportunities are from a technology point of view, how you can use your mobile phones, and apologies that the virtual reality system didn't work. We'll try again some other time. Get involved. And John is, I think, the point of contact on citizen science. Thank you very much.